What are the Cauchy-Riemann equations? Well, I want to study a complex differentiable, a holomorphic function, and I want to see some of the consequences of that holomorphicity. So let's consider a function little f from C to C, and I want that function to be complex differentiable. I want that function to be holomorphic. So I've got this limit of this difference quotient, right? That's the definition of the derivative of this function little f. Now, the idea will be to study what this limit means by thinking about the real and the imaginary part separately. So to get started on that, let's replace z, this complex number, with x plus iy, right? So I'm just separating out the real x and the imaginary y part. So I'm going to replace z with x plus iy. Now, this is a limit as h, a complex number, approaches zero. So I can keep on doing this idea of trying to separate out the real and the imaginary parts by rephrasing this limit as h approaches zero as a limit in the multivariable calculus sense. So I'll replace h by a plus bi, and then I'll take this limit as h goes to zero and replace it with the limit as a and b together approach zero comma zero. All right, so I'm gonna take the limit as a comma b approaches 0, 0. All right, now I can keep on using the tools of multivariable calculus here to analyze this situation, which we're really seeing in complex analysis. And to keep on going, let's introduce a new function, big F. So this function big F will be a function from R squared to C, which is really just another name for little f. So big F of x comma y is just little f of x plus iy. I just want to give a different name to this so I can talk about a function of two real variables as distinguished from this function little f, which is a function of a single complex variable. Now that lets me rewrite this difference quotient by separating out the real and the imaginary parts. So I've got big f of x plus a, y plus b minus f x comma y, all divided by a plus bi. Now, the whole thing is still complex valued. It's just that I'm writing everything in terms of this function big F, right? This function of two real variables. Okay, so I'm gonna take this thing and make a copy of it. Now, if this limit exists, if this limit of the two variables, A and B, approaching 0, 0, if that limit exists, then it's equal to the same limit when I just restrict to moving along the real axis. Right, when I approach 0, 0 just along the real axis. When I set b equals 0 and I take the limit as a approaches 0 after having fixed b equal to 0. Right, now, importantly, this is not the same as the limit a comma b approaching 0, 0. Right? I mean, this is a restricted situation. It's a huge, huge difference between these two limits. But if the limit as a comma b approaches 0, 0 exists, then this restricted limit where I set b equals 0 and I'm just looking at the situation as a approaches 0, then that limit exists and equals the same quantity. So I'm going to replace b by 0 in this expression. I'm going to simplify the difference quotient. And then I'll recognize what I've written down here as just the definition of the partial derivative of big F with respect to x, right? It's the definition of the partial derivative of big F with respect to its first input. All right, now that's half the story, right? So let me take this two variable limit, the definition of the complex derivative of little f, make another copy of it here. And I want to repeat the same story now, but instead of restricting to the real axis, I want to restrict to the imaginary axis. So if this two variable limit exists, then that means it has the same value as the limit where I approach 0, 0 just along the imaginary axis, where I set a equals 0, and I just consider the limit as b approaches 0 independently. Okay, so let's replace a by 0 and simplify that difference quotient. And now I've got a bi in the denominator, so I'm going to pull out that I from the denominator, and I've got the factor of 1 over I. And then I recognize that limit as being just the definition of the partial derivative of big F with respect to its second input, with respect to y. So if the function little f is holomorphic, right, if it's complex differentiable, then both of these expressions involving partials of big F are the same. They're both computing the complex derivative of little f. Right? This means that partial big F partial x is equal to 1 over I times partial big F partial y. Now, to continue on the theme of separating out the real and the imaginary parts of everything involved, let's introduce a couple more functions. we'll introduce a function u from r squared to r and a function v from r squared to r. And u and v will just pull out the real and the imaginary outputs of our functions, big F or little f for that matter, right? So big F of x comma y will be equal to u plus iv. Now, what this lets us do is then we can expand out partial big F partial x, right? Because big F is u plus iv, partial big F partial x is the same thing as partial u partial x plus I partial v partial x. And similarly, big F partial y is just partial u partial y plus I partial v partial y. Now I can distribute the 1 over I, and I can cancel the I over I here, and then I can equate the real and the imaginary parts of this equality, and then I can multiply the second equation by I. And what I end up deducing are two equations that are relating the partial derivatives in the real and the imaginary directions of the real and the imaginary parts of little f. Our original question was, what are the Cauchy-Riemann equations? We're about to see the Cauchy-Riemann equations, right? We started with this function little f. It's complex differentiable. We separated out the real and the imaginary inputs. We separated out the real and the imaginary outputs. We took a limit as a complex number approached zero, and we recognized that for multivariable calculus, that if that two-variable limit exists, then the limit along the real and the imaginary axes also exist and are equal to the same quantity. And consequently, what we get are these, the Cauchy-Riemann equations. Now, what are these equations saying? Well, the first equation here is saying that if I change the real input and I ask how does the real output change, right? That's partial u partial x. That's the same thing as if I wiggle the imaginary input and ask how the imaginary output changes. That's partial v partial y, and those are equal. The second equation is ever so slightly more subtle, right? It's saying that the change in the real output when I wiggle the imaginary input is negative the change in the imaginary output when I wiggle the real input. So what we've shown is that if a function f is holomorphic, then these Cauchy-Riemann equations are satisfied. There is a huge warning here, right? Just saying that these partial derivatives satisfy the Cauchy-Riemann equations is absolutely not enough to deduce that f is holomorphic, right? It's necessary that u and v be real differentiable, which is a stronger condition than just the existence of the partial derivatives. So what we've shown is that if the function f is holomorphic, then the Cauchy-Riemann equations are satisfied. The converse to this statement, well, if you know that u and v are real differentiable functions and they satisfy the Cauchy-Riemann equations, then the function f is holomorphic.